Recorded Books presents A Dance with Fate by Juliet Marillier. Narrated by Raphael Corkhill, Moira Quirk, and Alex Wyndham. Chapter 1. Liobhan. It's a glorious day. The sun is warm, the clouds are high puffs of white, the sea is as calm as it ever gets around Swan Island. We're sitting on the bench seats at the combat area, tingling with anticipation, knowing today's celebration marks the end of many months of grueling work. Work that we've loved and hated. Work that has tried us to the edge of our endurance and stretched us to the furthest bounds of our ability. Though, as Ahu has told us, in a crisis, you can always find a bit more to give. Work that has forged not only four warriors fit to join the island's permanent force, but also four true friends. They don't choose many. When we started training, there were 20 in our group. 15 went home. My brother Brock was lost on our first mission. Not dead, gone to the Otherworld, in a strange and baffling series of events. I miss him every day. I think of him every time I sing. I'm afraid he will never come back. All right, murmurs Dow, who's sitting beside me. Fine. I sound sharp, but I can't help it. I so wish Brock was here with us, enjoying this day, sharing our success. Look, there they are. We jump to our feet, shouting encouragement as our fellow trainees walk out onto the combat ground, staves in hand. They have the next display bout. Then it's Dow and me. We're well warmed up, ready to go, but we're not going to miss watching Hrothgar and Yarn show their talents. A great noise goes up, the voices of every resident of Swan Island cheering the combatants. There's nobody off on a mission at present, so there's a crowd of nearly 60 watching. Fighters, trainers, the folk who support the work of the island. And the elders. Canella, our leader, Ahu, our chief combat trainer, Breed and Ava and Haki, and the others. They're the best of the best. Those lucky enough and talented enough to be trained here are highly sought after when kings and chieftains need a task completed that's beyond the ability of their own men-at-arms. Or their own spies, if they have them. Sometimes our missions fall somewhat outside the rules of law. We do covert work. Secret work. That's why we live and train in such an isolated place. It's why few outsiders come here. And it's why the training period is so long. They've not only been testing our physical skills, they've been making sure we're trustworthy. Making sure we won't crack under torture, and making sure we can think for ourselves. It's unusual for them to take four new fighters at once. We know how lucky we are. And we know we've earned it. Hrothgar and Yarn enter the combat space. The field edge is marked by a circle of rope laid on the ground. The combatants halt, facing the elders, and with staves held upright, they bow. Canella gives a grave nod of acknowledgement. The crowd is quiet now. Three coppers on Hrothgar, whispers Dow in my ear. Done. Hrothgar, a Norseman, is taller and broader than Yarn. But the Armorican has a talent for deception. That makes him dangerous. Yarn's beaten me once or twice, using that skill, and I know it's a mistake to underestimate him. The two turn to face each other and bow again. They assume a fighting pose, staff gripped in both hands, one near the end, one partway up the shaft. They move about, backward and forward, jabbing in turn, each looking for an opening. Both men wear protective leather helms. Those things get hot as an oven and you end up with sweat obscuring your vision, but for this sort of fight you need them, and padded jerkins over their trousers and tunics. Wait for it, murmurs Dow. Ah, as Jan loses patience and rushes forward. His intention is clear, to knock aside Hrothgar's staff, then jab his own toward the other man's midriff. But he's not quick enough. The end of Hrothgar's weapon strikes Jan's arm hard. I know what that does. Your fingers go numb for long, precious moments. Jan skips back out of reach, winces, shaking his hand, flexing his fingers. Play actor, mutters Dow. I can't argue. When Jan grips his staff again, he's moved his hands. Now they're a handspan further along. This will place the staff slightly further away from Hrothgar than before. Jan's used his own error to his advantage, and now, under cover of a momentary hesitation, he puts one foot forward but leans his upper body back. Clever, I murmur. Hrothgar thrusts high to low, aiming for his opponent's chest. If Jan hadn't tricked him, this would be a bout-ending move. But Jan is closer than Hrothgar expected. The Armorican shifts his weight to the front foot and slides his staff through his front hand straight into Hrothgar's chest, between the lower ribs. Hrothgar folds. He can't breathe. His hand goes up in the gesture, I yield. The crowd roars. Jan steps back, waits for his opponent to catch his breath. It takes a while, then stands beside Hrothgar again as they acknowledge the applause. Dow and I don't wait to see them walk off. It's our bout now, the last of the day, an unarmed combat, best of three rounds. Can't bet on this one, says Dow with a crooked smile as we make our way down to the combat area, where someone is raking the ground, getting it ready for us. Folk do have a habit of throwing things when they get excited. Dust rises around the rake. But if you could, you'd bet on yourself to win, no doubt. No doubt. I'd wish you good luck, but I want Bran's blade, so I won't. Skill beats luck, I tell him, pausing to put on my helm. Gods, I hate these things. They get even hotter when you have a lot of hair to squash in, as I do. I've been tempted to cut my hair short, but when I'm not fighting, I'm a musician, and the long hair feels right when I dress up to perform. And useful when I'm working undercover and needing to look more like an ordinary woman and less like a Swan Island warrior. At a gesture from Ahu, Dow and I walk together into the combat space, where all is now in readiness. Folk cheer and shout as we go. This is a joyful day, not only for us, but for the whole community. A special day. Bran's blade is displayed on a cushion next to Canella. It will be awarded to the most outstanding fighter, not only of today, but of the whole training period. It's an old, well-kept dagger, beautifully balanced, of plain design, apart from the tiny image of a bee in flight, carved on the oak hilt. The weapon is said to have belonged to the man who founded Swan Island long ago, a man who was called an outlaw, but who showed great heart, spirit, and generosity to his fighting team. His son and his grandson were in their turn part of the island community, and there are descendants of that original crew still among us. Nobody gets to keep Bran's blade forever. One of us will be given it today to look after and to use until a new custodian earns the privilege through some act of outstanding valor or skill. A training and testing period, such as the one that saw me and my three comrades win places on the island, happens only rarely. It's more usual for fighters to join the community one at a time, each coming here by his or her own path. You have to be capable. You have to be skilled. And you need the right attitude. I thought Dow lacked that when I first met him. His manner was arrogant, scornful, aloof, as you might expect from a chieftain's son. The mission changed my opinion. It changed both of us. But the old rivalry still remains. We both want Bran's blade. We both want to be the best. We salute the elders, bow to Canella, position ourselves within the rope guideline. "Three rounds," calls out Aku, informing the crowd of what we already know. "Win two, and you're the victor. Set foot outside the boundary, and you lose that round immediately. No eye gouging, no groin strikes. Remember, it's a display bout, not a fight to the death. Break those rules, and you'll not only forfeit the fight, you'll be emptying privies and hauling goods up from the ferry for a good long while. Understood?" This is probably meant for me. I do have a reputation for using dirty tricks to win if the situation requires it. But I know better than to try that today of all days. Dao and I both nod and murmur, "Understood."
"Begin," calls Aku.
I have a plan. As we dance around, I edge toward the rope. Close enough?
Yes.
I dive for Dao's knees, aiming to send him toppling back. But as he falls, he twists, managing to land inside the field. I grab at his leg. He slips from my grasp, and almost before I know it, we're both on the ground. He's got me in a hold we call the crab, with him underneath me on his back, his legs hooked over my hips and his arm around my throat. Shit! It's yield or pass out within a count of five. I lift my hand and make the yield sign to show I'm forfeiting the bout. Dao relaxes his grip. I suck in air. I'm shaking with fury as we disentangle ourselves and rise to our feet. Not angry with Dao, furious with myself for not seeing that coming, for being too slow. A pox on it. Now I have to win both remaining bouts. I stand. I make myself breathe. This wretched helm is driving me crazy. It's so hot and I'm sweating like a pig. I unbuckle the strap and take the thing off, throwing it beyond the field edge. It's not compulsory to wear them for these unarmed bouts. We're supposed to use our own judgment. After a moment, Dao takes his own helm off and discards it. Gives me a little smile, or more of a smirk. In that expression, I see the old Dao, the one I didn't like much, and I grip my teeth. I'll win this one and the next. I want Bran's blade. If I win it, I'll be the first woman to do so. Even Breed, a seasoned fighter and a combat trainer, has never had custody of the weapon. "Go, Liobhan!" yells someone from the crowd, and a chorus of shouting follows. Some for me, some for Dao, some for both of us. I steady myself. Bout two, and I need to get the advantage quickly.
"Begin!" calls Aku.
Dao closes straight away for a grapple, but I'm expecting that after the last bout. I duck under his grab and drive my elbow into his liver. Cruel, but effective. He groans and collapses, curled up on himself in agony. When he can make himself move, he stretches out a hand and signals yield. I help him to his feet. Part of me wants to say sorry. He's my friend, and I've hurt him. But you don't let friendship get in the way of a good fight. One more round, and I've got it. Dao's weakened by that blow. I can do this. I look across and meet his eye. He's a bit pale, and he's breathing hard, as I am. Sweat sheens his face and darkens his fair hair. His eyes are narrowed, his jaw is set tight. I glare right back at him.
"Begin!" comes the call.
We circle. No sound from the crowd now. A deathly silence lies over all. Then, lightning quick, Dao feints a straight punch at my stomach. I grab his arm and pull him further off balance, then hook his foot out from under him. He stumbles, rolls, recovers, is back on his feet.
"Keep moving, Liobhan."
I go for his waist. I'm a better fighter on the ground than he is. If I can tackle him down, he slides free and ankle taps me. I stumble, fall, roll to my feet and put a few steps between us to buy time. He grins. Too cocky by half. I'll win this.
I have to.
I grab for Dow's leg. He skips back out of reach, catches his foot on something and falls heavily. His head hits the ground so hard I hear the thud. I move to leap on him and get him in a leg lock, but suddenly I'm still. The crowd falls silent. Dow is lying face up on the hard-packed earth, with his arms flung out wide like those of a sleeping child. His eyes are closed. His face is a ghost's, sickly pale, and he's very, very still. My heart skips a beat as I kneel down beside him. There was a time, not so long ago, when I thought I'd killed a man simply by pushing him away a bit too hard. That man lived, and so will Dow. He's breathing.
Step back, Liobhan.
Arku is beside me, and others are striding toward us. Canella and Swan Island's resident healer, Fergus. I move out of their way, but I'm not going anywhere until I know Dow's all right. People do get knocked out from time to time during our practice bouts. You can't run a school of Warcraft without people sometimes injuring each other or themselves, though all our training is carried out under strict rules to keep us safe. Dow still hasn't moved. Fergus performs various checks, then shakes his head and murmurs to Arku, who calls out,
"Stretcher!"
Two men bring the stretcher. Four men, under the healer's direction, lift Dow extremely carefully onto it, keeping his body as still as they can. I want to help, but Arku motions me away. They carry the stretcher out at a snail's pace, as if the slightest jolt might do the occupant damage. Arku and Canella stay behind. They're examining the spot where Dow fell. As I watch, Arku lifts something out of the earth. It looks like a leather cord with something strung on it, maybe a good luck charm. The sort of thing that folk throw sometimes when they get excited. Too small to be dangerous. Or so one would think.
"He may have tripped on this," says Canella. "Easy enough to miss it with the rake."
He glances toward the onlookers, who are talking together in hushed voices.
"Sheer bad luck."
He turns to look at me.
"You didn't see this?"
He shows me briefly, then slips the little item in his pocket. It's a token in the form of a bird, and I know who it belongs to, as Canella likely does. The daughter of one of our cooks. A child of five, so excited by the fighting that she threw her lucky charm into the ring. I didn't see that, but I heard her screaming,
"Come on, Liobhan!"
No, it must have been partly buried. There was a lot of dust blowing around. I glance over toward the gate, where the stretcher is at this moment being carried out of view. Will he be all right?
I can't answer that.
Arku sounds grim.
You'd best go back to your quarters, Liobhan.
Perhaps seeing something on my face, he softens a little.
I'll make sure you're kept informed.
I go to my quarters and fetch clean clothing. Then it's the bathhouse, where I strip off what I'm wearing. I scrub every inch of my body. I undo my hair from its tightly plaited combat style and wash it. I dry myself and get into the gown and overdress I've brought with me, slipping my feet into soft shoes. I bundle up the shirt and trousers to wash later. I go to the armory and clean my leather jerkin, my belt, and my boots until they're spotless. One or two people are about, but I don't look at them, and they don't speak to me. By the time I get back to the women's quarters, much smaller than the men's, since most of the island's population is male, I have my fears under better control. But I can't get the image out of my mind. Someone once described Dow as a handsome prince from a tale. That was how he looked, a dead prince, fallen on the battlefield in the flower of his youth, golden hair dusty and bloodied, lids closed over the sky-blue eyes, skin shadowy pale. How long will it be before Arku has news for me? Dow must be conscious by now, surely. I hang around outside the women's quarters for a while. Everyone's left the combat area. People have returned to their work, and outwardly, this looks like any clear spring day on the island. The breeze has got up. It's turning the sea to whitecaps. Gulls circle and wheel overhead, crying out. Everyone will be busy. Some will be preparing the evening meal, tending to sheep or chickens, repairing drains or buildings or dry stone walls. Some will be practicing with weapons or maintaining their fitness by climbing or running or doing exercises. Some will be doing other forms of training. Swan Island must always have people ready to be sent on a mission. Calls for our expert services can come at short notice. That's what happened last summer, when we went undercover as travelling minstrels. Brock and I were chosen because of our experience singing and playing back home. Oh, I so wish he was here with me now. Why hasn't anyone brought news of Dow? I pace up and down a while, asking myself questions with no answers. In the end, I go to the infirmary to find out what's happening, even though Aku told me to stay in the quarters. The door to the stone building is ajar, but there's no sound from inside. I don't know if that's good or bad. I stand outside waiting until Aku spots me and comes out, closing the door behind him.
Liobhan, best if you are not here right now.
His carefully controlled tone makes me sick with worry. His expression is somber. A flood of words is ready to burst from me, but I hold it back. Instead, I say quietly, I just want to know how he is.
Aku sighs. That was a severe knock to the head, and Fergus tells me it was in a particularly delicate spot. Dow has regained consciousness, but he's not well. He's in pain and confused, as you might expect, and it seems his sight may be affected.
A chill breath of dread passes through me. You mean, how bad? May I see him? I put a hand up to my mouth, press the back of it against my lips to shut myself up, otherwise I'll wail or curse or do something stupid.
Fergus says no visitors. He requested the assistance of another healer, and we've sent for that man. Until he arrives, Creadon's helping.
Aku folds his arms and gives me a direct sort of look.
I see you're upset, and I understand why. But you're not needed here at present.
But Dow's my friend. I want to know he's all right. I want to know that he'll be able to stay here and fight and have a future.
Liobhan, go, and stay away this time. Make yourself useful elsewhere.
Jan and Hrothgar find me as I'm washing my clothes with such violence that they threaten to come apart at the seams. One of the good things about living on Swan Island, and there are many, is that you're surrounded by comrades, and those comrades understand how it feels when you get things wrong. Hrothgar, the tall Norseman, hauls himself up to sit on the workbench with his legs dangling, and Jan asks in his soft Armorican accent if I'm all right. I shut my eyes for a moment, my hands still in the wash tub.
Want to talk about it? Asks Hrothgar.
I lift the trousers out of the trough and wring them out hard. Jan reaches past me without a word and does the same with the shirt. Have you heard anything? I make myself ask. Any news on how he's doing?
Nothing yet. I heard him shouting earlier. Sore head, I suppose. He went down hard.
Shouting what?
Not words, just angry noises.
I'm silent as I go out the back to hang the garments on a line, where the wind will dry them quickly. The two men follow. We stand there a while, looking out toward the mainland. There's a small settlement over there, part of the Swan Island community. It houses a secretive training establishment known as the Barn, a stable block and exercise area for horses, and accommodation for the folk who work there. Dow and I trained for our mission in the Barn, with my brother. God, Was that only 3 seasons ago? The mission, losing Brock, having to go home and explain to my parents, then coming back here and working myself to the breaking point to win a permanent place. All of that between one summer and the next spring? Today's display should have been a celebration of our achievement. It still can be. Dow may appear at supper time, a little pale and unsteady, but managing a wry comment or two and a bite to eat. He may be back to his old self by tomorrow or the next day. I heard they were getting a healer from the mainland, I say, wondering if what I see out there is one of our boats or a fishing vessel from elsewhere. The men don't comment. He tripped on something so small, just a strip of cord and a tiny amulet. I don't know how it could do so much damage.
He struck his head hard.
Jan's voice is grave.
These things happen, even when you are careful. Simple bad luck.
It was my fault. I make myself say it. If he'd been wearing his helm, he wouldn't have been so badly injured. He took it off because I took mine off, to make the bout fair. And look what happened.
You can't blame yourself, says Hrothgar. This was pure accident, and removing the helm was Dow's choice.
There's a long silence then. I suspect the two of them are thinking what I'm thinking. Eventually, I say it. Better to get it out now, to my friends, than have to ask Ahu, or worse still, Canella, who is the highest figure of authority on Swan Island. What if he's really badly hurt? So badly that he can't stay on here. What would happen?
That's a question for the elders, not us, says Hrothgar. Folk do sometimes stay on after injuries, says Jan. If there is other work they can do, something that is needed.
That's true as far as it goes. A person with a lame leg could still maintain weaponry, draw maps, devise strategy, teach others. A damaged arm would mean no more combat, but that person could still keep night watch or help look after the sheep. A head injury is more challenging, but the codes of Swan Island, the ones we all live by, mean the community stands by its wounded and broken. There's a warrior named Gus on the island, a man of around 40 who has bouts of dizziness and confusion from a blow to the head. He's big and strong, but he can't fight anymore. They could have sent Gus home, but Swan Island had been his life since he was a young man of our age, and he had no other home, so they found a job for him. He lives in a lean-to at the back of the Druid's hut. He fetches Creadon's meals, helps tend his little garden, and does other useful things such as mixing ink and gathering quills for pens. He and Creadon watch over each other, and the whole community watches over the two of them. Swan Island may be full of fierce fighters, but tolerance and compassion rank high on its list of codes, and there's work for everyone. Or there should be. I can't think of any job on the island that would be safe for a blind person, and from the looks on my companions' faces, I deduce they've reached the same conclusion. Nobody's asking the hardest question. What if he dies?
He'll get better, Hrothgar says. This is Thou we're talking about. He's unbreakable.
Unstoppable, says Jan. Before you know it, he will be fully recovered. Meanwhile, enjoy the reprieve from his biting wit.
Supper time comes, and there's still no news. The mood in the dining hall is subdued. On most nights, we have music after the meal, and sometimes dancing. We work long, hard days, and that's a good way to end them. Generally, the band consists of Ahu on the boran, me singing and playing the whistle, a woman named Ima on a second whistle, and whoever else feels like joining in. My brother Brock is a skilled harpist whose singing voice could melt the stoniest of hearts. Every time we play without him, I feel his absence as an ache in my chest. There will be no music tonight. I don't even bother taking my whistle with me to the hall. There's a chill in me that runs deep. I can't keep my thoughts in order. If he's going to die, they would have told us.
That's no comfort at all.
Maybe they just can't work out what's wrong.
Very possible, since they sent for the second healer. And if that man is not yet here, we may have to wait until morning for news. The healer might have been in the middle of setting a broken leg or delivering a child. He might live some distance away.
Liobhan?
Hrothgar digs me in the ribs, jolting me back to the here and now. How long have I been sitting over my untouched meal, staring at nothing? Ahu is in the doorway of the dining hall. He looks tired and sad. The whole place has gone silent.
We'll be moving Dao across to the mainland in the morning, Ahu says.
He's working on sounding calm and confident, with some success.
Fergus will go over with him, and the other healer, when he arrives, will meet with them there. We can look after Dao more effectively at the barn, at least until we have further insight into his condition.
A pause. I glance at my companions. Jan on my left, Hrothgar on my right, and hope someone will ask the question I can't ask. It comes from Breed, who is seated at a different table.
How is Dao faring, Ahu? Has his condition improved at all?
A murmur goes around the hall. Everyone is concerned. Dao may have a habit of rubbing folk the wrong way, but he's one of us.
I wish I had better news for you, says Ahu. He's drifting in and out of consciousness, in pain and not making much sense. He still has no vision. We must hope that condition is temporary.
Before anyone else can get a word in, it's clear people want to speak. Breed says,
No more questions now. You can see Ahu's tired. Someone fetch him food and drink, and let us eat in peace. We're all concerned, and we all know Dao will receive the best care that can possibly be provided. In the morning, you get up as usual, you eat your breakfast, and you get on with your work.
Ahu leaves most of his supper. He drinks his ale, has a quiet word with Canella and Breed and some of the other elders, then leaves the hall. Since he's given no sign of wanting to talk to me, I don't follow him out with my own questions. I'd like to go to the infirmary and offer my services. My mother is a healer, and I couldn't have grown up in her household without learning useful skills. I could sit up with Dao overnight so Fergus could catch some sleep. I can make poultices and administer drafts, and I know when to call in someone with more expertise. But it feels like I'm the last person who should offer. The night is endless. Either I'm lying wide awake on my bed trying not to disturb the other women, or I'm having nightmares so black I wake drenched in sweat and shaking. Before dawn, I get up, dress, and walk all the way to the other end of the island and back, so fast that if Breed could see me, she would reprimand me for taking unnecessary risks on the cliff paths. Which would be funny if I could find the least scrap of fun in me anywhere, because when Dao was asked to assess my performance in our shared mission, who does that kind of thing, he identified my tendency toward risk-taking as both an asset and a liability. When the community buildings come into view, I slow my pace to a brisk stride. I'm not a great believer in gods or their capacity to respond to our prayers. But I pray now, a childish sort of prayer, to anyone who might be listening. Let him be better today. Let him speak properly, even if it's only to curse his misfortune. Let him open his eyes and see.
Ahu is up early too. He's coming along the path toward me, wearing his big fur cloak as if ready for travel. We meet and halt.
Liobhan.
His tone is grave and kind and deadly serious.
We're taking him over on the boat after breakfast. He had a restless night, and is much the same this morning. I want you to come with us. Go and pack a bag.
The healers need an assistant who knows what she's doing.
Of course. I'm glad I can be of some help.
Ahu folds his arms and looks down at the ground.
There's something further you need to know.
We've sent a message to Dao's family, telling them he's been seriously injured and asking what they want to do. If they send someone here, it's possible, even likely, that the person may want to speak to you. You understand why we would not want their representative on the island.
I do understand. The code of secrecy is long established in the Swan Island community. The more folk learn about what we do, the harder it becomes to keep missions covert, and the less likely it is that we'll be hired. That's not all. Many of our folk have secrets they don't want known. Dark events of the past that are best set behind them. The island code forgives the time before a person joins us. All that is asked is that the new arrival treads a different path from that moment on. A better, wiser, braver path. So yes, I understand what he's saying, and in Dao's case, it's horribly ironic. His kinsfolk possibly coming here. That can't happen. Around us, dawn is breaking. The sea is turning from lead to sparkling gold. Birds wing their way out from the ledges, calling to one another. How do I frame the next question? When Dao told me about his past, it was in strictest confidence. Did you consult Dao about sending his family a message? I know he wouldn't want that. You may not be aware that they are estranged. Worse than that. Much worse. It took a long while for Dao to start confiding in me. Growing up, he suffered terribly at the hands of his brothers, and it scarred him deep. His father did nothing to stop it. Dao ran away from home at 13. He once told me he hoped he would never see his brothers again. What if his father decides to take him home? That is the last thing Dao would want. The very last thing.
Ahu sighs. We tried to ask him, of course, he says, but he's in no fit state to give us a coherent response. When he's conscious, he's not lucid. The elders discussed it at length, I promise you. Dao came to us from a place other than his family home. We did understand he had lived elsewhere for some time, young as he is. We wouldn't have accepted him for training without knowing his origins. He gave us his father's name, the place, no more. He's very badly hurt, Liobhan. We don't know if the healers will be able to help him. And, to be blunt, there's a possibility he won't survive this. His father is a chieftain, a man of means and influence. We came to a decision that we should advise the family, just as we advised your family when your brother left us so abruptly.
That was different, I say, knowing I shouldn't argue the point, but unable to forget the look on Dao's face when he spoke of his brothers. My family is not like Dao's.
We are obliged to tell them, whatever they are like. Fergus thought he might die during the night. If he survives, he may be blind. His mind may be affected.
Ahu hesitates. I wait. Whatever's coming, it's not good.
The situation is complicated by our own need for secrecy. We don't want Swan Island under public scrutiny. The less this tale is spread abroad, the better. So, we've advised them early. We've made it clear the injury was accidental. We've let them know we have two expert healers on the job and that we will cover the cost of treatment.
Did they even know Dao was on Swan Island? He wouldn't want...
We felt it necessary to advise them, Liobhan, as I've explained.
I mutter a coarse oath, then an apology.
Sorry, but he'll hate this. He'll hate it so much. What if they decide to come here, to confront us face to face?
To the extent we can, we must go along with the family's wishes in the matter. If you're to be useful, you must exercise self-control,
even if you don't like the way this is being handled.
I understand.
What I understand is that this is going to be a real test, and a hard one.
We have time to prepare. Their family holding is quite far away, closer to the scene of our mission in Brefna than to Swan Island, but further to the east. And I imagine that even if they do come here, we'll have due notice.
You'll come over to the settlement too? The ghost of a smile crosses Ahu's broad face.
I'll be there. I carry my own share of the responsibility for this.
I should go and pack, I say. Shall I ask Hrothgar to pack a bag for Dal?
Thank you. Just a change of clothing and his small personal items, for now at least.
As I return to the women's quarters, where the others are just starting to stir, I consider those last words. They sound ominous.
Still,
the other healer hasn't seen Dal yet. Someone did say he's an expert on head injuries. Perhaps all will be well. By the time an answer comes to the message, Dao's vision may be fully restored and his head clear. If that happens, the first thing he'll want is to have that final bout again. I think of him beating me and claiming Bran's blade, then trying to keep the grin of triumph from his face as he pays me the 3 coppers he owes me from our wager on Hrothgar and Yarn's fight. I want to see that. I want to see my friend smile again. Winning a fight, claiming a prize, making the elders proud. Right now, none of that seems to matter.
Chapter 2. Dal. Sounds screech and clash and assault my ears. My head shivers like a bell struck by a heavy hammer. My eyes hurt. My neck hurts. Some of the sounds come from my own mouth. I can't stop them. Groans, moans, grunts, shouts, but not words. The words are in my head, but they won't come out right. I'm hot, then cold, then hot again, throwing off the blankets and shouting at Fergus as if this were his fault. Ahu is close by. I hear him talking, though he's keeping it to a murmur, and I shout at him too. I curse and swear and rage, and it's the garbled ravings of a crazy man. If this is how things are going to be from now on, I'll be out of this hut the first chance I get, and I'll run for the cliffs and hurl myself off. At least that way, it will be over quickly. They put me on a boat. The sea goes up and down, and I am sick. Someone wipes my mouth and I push them away hard. Then there's someone holding me, someone strong, and I sit there in the dark as the ferry bounces over the waves and my face is damp with sea spray and I hear the birds screaming farewell. If I could pray, I would pray to be as I was before. But I do not believe in gods. Men are cruel. Fate is cruel. I can see almost nothing. One eye looks out on utter darkness. The other opens to a shadowy world, all greys in which shapes move but cannot be identified. I cannot fight. I cannot ride. I cannot be the warrior I have worked so hard to become. I cannot be strong. I am as I was before, the helpless child. The boy without answers, the one who lived with fear. I wish I believed in gods.
Chapter 3. Liobhan. Dal won't talk to me. He hardly talks to anyone, though at least now he can make himself understood. For a while I wondered if his wits were damaged along with his eyes, and although Fergus and the other healer, a soft-voiced, dark-skinned man named Jabba, never spoke about this in my hearing, I know they did too. I hate what's happening to Dal. When we were on the mission, he had to pretend he couldn't speak. That was part of his cover. And he was good at it. The handsome prince, the proudest of the trainee warriors, put in a convincing performance as a mute stable-hand. I see that voiceless lad in him now, on the rare occasions when he comes out from the isolated part of the barn where he's being tended. He can understand us. His responses make that clear. But he's all closed in on himself, like a beaten animal hiding away in a dark corner. The healers are doing their best. They're making sure he eats, and getting him up and walking around with one or both of them to help. They're trying different things with his eyes. Jabba has told me quietly that Dao prefers I do not tend to him. That's like a slap in the face, though there are plenty of other tasks to keep me busy. I gather herbs for the healers. I prepare soothing eye washes and various tonics. When Fergus and Jabba don't need me, I help muck out stables. I fetch water. I sweep floors and chop wood. I help prepare meals. I run through the exercises that keep me strong. There are other Swan Island fighters training at the barn, but they stay out of our way most of the time, and I don't ask them about their upcoming mission. If they're over here, that will be what they're preparing for. I see them at mealtimes, and I sleep in the same communal quarters, where a screen separates men and women. Right now, I'm the only woman at the barn. In the settlement around it, there are 8 separate houses, and families live in them, but they're all part of the Swan Island community. One husband and wife team builds and maintains fishing boats. Others look after the horses that are stabled here for the purpose of training us in mounted combat and to provide transport when required. A former fighter, injured on duty and now reliant on the aid of a stick for walking, looks after the pigeons that carry messages between Swan Island and various strategically situated friendly households. These are dotted all over Erin. There's an herbalist, and she has her own stillroom attached to her cottage. That gives me an idea. Have you tried a wash with parsley and calamint? I ask Jabba when I encounter him outside the barn, taking a break from his duties. My mother finds that effective to reduce inflammation of the eyes, and there's a tea that can be brewed from dried holly leaves. I don't suppose we'll have time for that, but I could gather the leaves and start the drying just in case. When Jabba does not reply immediately, I add, I know that kind of remedy won't restore his sight, but the wash will help with the pain, and the tea will provide some ease of mind.
By all means, gather the herbs and prepare the wash, Jabba says. Ease of mind. I wish we could provide that for him now. He is greatly troubled. In despair, I think. Unable or unwilling to help himself. That makes our task harder. We have few answers. It's good to get away from the barn for a while, because this place is, in effect, an outpost of Swan Island. I have to get Ahu's permission, then speak to the guards on duty as I walk out of the settlement. They need to know where I'm going and for how long. They advise me to keep an eye out for trouble. I have my big knife at my belt and a little one hidden in my boot, as well as the implement I use for cutting herbs. As I set out toward the woodland with the willow basket over my arm and my trousers on under my skirt, I must look like a curious mixture of herbalist and fighter. But I'm still within the domain of Swan Island, a place quite unlike the outside world. I love life on the island. I love combat. I love testing myself and becoming stronger and facing new challenges. I love living among comrades with the same zest for this unusual existence. And I love the cliffs and crashing waves and wild skies of the island itself, so different from the quiet forest where I grew up. But I hate what's happening now. My friend had a wretched childhood. Now he faces an uncertain future. If anyone deserves to stay on Swan Island and be a warrior, the best of the best, it's Dao. I harvest the herbs I need, finding them in a sunny clearing to the south. There's holly in the woods. I cut some of that as well, in case we're here long enough for me to dry out the leaves.
Those tasks done, I take off my boots and sit beside the stream for a while, letting the cool water run over my feet, and thinking of the time when I had to go home and tell my parents that Brock was gone. Dao came as my escort, and our household was a shock to him. I could see that from the first. He couldn't quite believe we were so kind to one another. He seemed astonished that my father was so patient, always ready to listen if someone needed to spill out their woes, always offering a word of comfort or advice or plain common sense. My father is a man of quite intimidating appearance. Folk who don't know him often expect him to be slow-witted and belligerent. In fact, he's the opposite. It's my mother who is short-tempered, though she works hard to keep it under control. I wish she were here now. I can see her marching into the sick room and giving the patient a sharp talking to. "What's happened has happened," she would say. "It's hard, I know, but you're strong, you're brave, you've got folk who care about you. Shouting and throwing things is the response of an unruly child, Dao. You are a grown man." I wish I could do that, but he doesn't want me. I walk back to the settlement and head for the herbalist's cottage, where Deirdre, a youngish woman with her dark hair tied back in a kerchief, finds me a corner in her stillroom and leaves me to prepare my wash while she completes a decoction. Three cats weave around her ankles while she works, one ginger, one black, one tabby-striped. Deirdre has heard about Dao. Both Fergus and Jabba have asked her for advice. "Do you think he'll get his sight back eventually?" I don't want to hear the answer, but I ask the question anyway. "Have you seen anything like this before?" She takes her time to reply. I concentrate on chopping the leaves and trying not to think too hard. "Like this? No," Deirdre says eventually. "I've seen a man blind from a sickness who got his sight back, partly at least." A glimmer of hope. "What was done to treat that man?" "A long period of rest, leeches, poultices, but it was different from your friend's condition, not caused by a blow, but by ill humours of some kind. Those ill humours left his body with time, and his eyes recovered quite well." "Quite well?" "He was a shepherd. He didn't regain full vision, but he could see well enough to do the job safely." I don't reply. To do what we do on Swan Island, Dao needs to be able to see keenly, sharply. Quite well won't be good enough. And he's not the kind of man who'll be content to feed the chickens and turn the compost heap. "Try your eyewash and your holly tea," says Deirdre. "We do what we can. We have to make our peace with that." I feel an unreasonable anger rising and I squash it down. None of this is Deirdre's fault, or Jabba's, or Fergus's. It's not mine either, though guilt hangs over me anyway. A personal dark cloud. It's chance, it's fate, it's horrible ill luck. And when I've got everything ready, when I've said farewell to Deirdre and walked back to the barn, I find out just how ill that luck really is for Dao. Because a pigeon has come in with a message from Lord Scarnall. His representative is on his way here, and he's bringing a lawman with him.
Chapter 4. Dao. Fergus makes me walk, up and down, around the barn so I can hear the sounds of people training, the clash of blades, the knock of staves, the shouts of encouragement or challenge. At first I walk with my arm through his, a degree of intimacy I find humiliating. Then I put my hand on his shoulder, which means I either trip or bump into things. He doesn't always warn me. When I challenge this, he says I will learn to sense objects close at hand and to avoid them. What utter bollocks. It is quite clear. They do not expect me to regain my sight, though nobody is prepared to tell me this. They think, perhaps, that I would shout, throw things, run mad. They wish to be kind to the crippled man, the man who was ruined at the very moment of achieving his goal. What is supposed to be my goal now? To walk 20 feet without falling over? To eat my breakfast porridge without spilling it down my shirt? A pox on that! Jarber is kind. So kind, I want to hit the man. Then, one afternoon, things change. Jarber is washing my eyes with a cool, sweet-smelling mixture. It feels good. I am forced to admit that. There's a knock on the door, and it's Arhu. "I'll come in, if I may," he says. "Dao, how are you feeling today? I want to deliver the withering response this platitude deserves, but I shrug and grunt instead. Liobhan's eye wash is effective, simple as it is," observes Jarber, telling me something I didn't know. "I will ask her to gather more of the herbs and to show me how she makes it up. The inflammation has reduced further." There's a silence. Then Arhu says, "I have some news. A message came earlier today. From your family, Dao, in response to our notification of your injury. I stand up so violently that there's a crash and a splash and an exclamation from Jarber. Before I can move further, strong hands restrain me." "Calm yourself," says Arhu. "Use what you've been taught. You may not be on a mission now, but you are still one of us. Now sit down. No matter how badly hurt you are, you exercise self-discipline at all times. Yes?" What complete rot. I'm blind. I'm useless. And he expects me to go on acting like a warrior? What am I supposed to be fighting? Dreams and shadows? I sit. Arhu moves his hands to my shoulders. He keeps holding on until my breathing calms. The man has patience. I can't slow my heart. It's drumming hard. The monster of the past is on the hunt, and it's closing in on me. "News," I make myself say. It comes out as a strangled squeak. "What news?" Inside me, the trapped child is muttering to himself, "Don't let them come here, don't let them find me, don't let them take me." To say your father is displeased would be an understatement. Arhu moves to seat himself a little further away. I hear the scrape of wood on slate as he shifts the bench, and beside me the soft sounds of Jarber mopping up the spillage and retrieving the pieces of his broken bowl. He assumes that if your condition doesn't improve soon, you'll need to return home. "No, Dao, sit easy." And that you'll require an escort to Oakhill. He makes it clear that he wants some answers. I'm so full of fear and rage and darkness that I hardly know what will come out of my mouth. I can't be the warrior Arhu still wants me to be. That man's gone, vanished in an instant on the training ground. There's only this man, this helpless apology for a man, whose eyes are brimming with tears. My teeth are clenched so tight, my whole jaw aches. "I'm not going back," I say. "I'm not going. They can't make me." Arhu doesn't tell me I sound like a child. He waits a while, and Jarber returns to bathing my eyes. There is a second bowl, I suppose, and a generous supply of whatever it is Liobhan made. Why is she over here anyway? She should be back on the island doing her work. There was no reason for her to come here. "We need to talk," Arhu says. "Or rather, I need to explain some things to you, and you need to sit quietly and listen. I understand your fury, Dao. I understand how frustrating this must be for you. But you are still a member of our Swan Island community, and I need you to put the community's needs ahead of your own. Will you listen while I explain?" I don't nod, because I know it will hurt, but I grunt a yes. Who'd have thought those skills I exercised on our mission in Brefna, where I played the part of a mute man, would come in useful now? Arhu explains the need to avoid all eyes turning to Swan Island if there's a fuss about what's happened to me. He reads part of the message from my father, sent by pigeon to the court of Dalriera and carried on here by one of King Oren's riders. You supply scant detail of this incident. That leads me to ponder exactly what the true circumstances may have been. How is it possible that a man could suffer such serious injury outside a situation of real conflict? Quite clearly, the incident requires further investigation. My representative will be accompanied by a lawman, since it may be necessary for this matter to proceed to a formal hearing. You tell me my son may be blind. He is not yet 20 years old. You might consider... Well, never mind that. Ahu falls silent. I hear a crackle. Perhaps he set the parchment down on the table. Read the rest. I want to hear all of it. The false compassion, the sudden interest in my welfare, the tone of lofty superiority. 6 years have passed since I ran away from home, but it's plain my father has not changed at all. When Ahu does not reply, I growl, "Read it!" Ahu clears his throat. Jabba is using a soft cloth to dry my face gently. The eye wash has run down my cheeks like fragrant tears. You might consider what compensation could possibly be adequate for snatching away a young man's future prospects, for robbing him of the best part of his lifetime. You might weigh up the cost to a family of supporting a kinsman who will be completely dependent on others for many years. My representative and his party are traveling to your location as I write this. All being well, they should reach you in less than 12 days. I will expect you to receive them and to ensure appropriate discussions take place promptly. If my son is well enough to travel, and if it is established that his condition cannot improve sufficiently for him to remain with you, the party has the means to convey him back to Oakhill. I don't shout this time. I don't try to leap up and blunder out the door. Here at the barn, there are no cliffs close by, only watchful guards. But what I feel must show plainly on my face, because Jabba puts his hand on my shoulder and Ahu says quietly, "I would have spared you that. But the fact is this representative is already on the way. He will want answers, and it's in your best interest that we prepare ourselves as well as possible. We'll need our own lawman." I find my voice. "I'm not going. I'm not going home. I'm a grown man, and I'm not answerable to my father." Another silence. "Jabber," Ahu says, "you might take a walk in the garden. Perhaps find yourself some refreshments. I'll stay with Dao until you return." Jabba retreats. I can barely hear his footsteps. I explained to Liobhan, and I'll explain to you why it's so important that we keep this contained, Ahu says. "The less information spreads to folk outside the Swan Island community, the better." He tells me, what I can guess already, that if there's a legal hearing, too much attention will fall on Swan Island. Our activities, most of which are secret, may be exposed in a way that threatens the island community's future. The local folk have an idea of what we do. Further afield, we are either a mystery or unknown, and that's the way the elders want it to stay. None of them wants a formal hearing. If your father demands compensation in silver, it will be paid, though the amount will be negotiable. If he wants something else, they'll try to provide it. "Whatever he wants," I say, trying to still the shivering that has taken over my body. "You can be sure it doesn't include welcoming me back home. That part is lies. I was never wanted there. They despised me even when I had all my faculties." Ahu doesn't try to contradict this. "Nonetheless, he sent the letter, and when his representative and the lawman arrive, we must deal with them. Dao, understand that when we made the decision to notify your father, we feared you might not last the night. You're seriously ill. Yes, you are not a child, but a man, and a man makes his own choices. We must hope this injury does not limit those choices. Fergus is capable. Jabba is highly qualified, but your father, with his resources, may well be able to find someone more expert, someone with a deeper understanding of your condition. And his household will surely accommodate you in more comfort than we can do on the island, or here at the barn. You say they don't want you back, But years have passed since you fell out with them. Is it not possible the situation has changed? Or might you yourself not take steps to change it? Ha! Change the household at Oakhill? Not in 1,000 years. Is Ahu telling me there's no future for me on Swan Island, or even here at the barn? No work I could possibly set my hand to? The answer must be yes, or he would offer, surely. I can't bring myself to ask. I can't bear to hear him say it. My mind goes down a devious pathway. They could lie. The elders could tell this representative that my eyes are slowly improving, and that if I stay under the care of Jarber and Fergus for long enough, I will fully regain my sight and resume my place in the warrior band. They could point out that they are paying for my care. The representative could report all that back to my father, whose annoyance at not receiving a bag of silver in compensation would be outweighed by his relief that I am not, after all, coming home to be a burden to him for the rest of my life. I consider telling Ahu that if he insists on sending me back, I will kill myself before it can happen. I know where the weapon store is, here at the barn. I wonder how it feels to slit your own throat. Liobhan told us you were estranged from your family, Ahu says quietly. Estranged? You could put it that way? What else did Liobhan say? If she's betrayed any confidences, I'll kill her. Only I won't, because now that I'm blind, she'll win any fight hands down. About your family circumstances, very little. She was upset to hear that we had contacted them without consulting you first. We did try to do that, Dao. At that point, you were not capable of understanding. He goes quiet for a little, then adds, I thought you and Liobhan were friends. It might do you good to talk to her. I've told them 1,000 times that I don't want to talk to Liobhan. The moment I hear her voice, I'll be reminded all over again that I'm not the fit and healthy person I was. That I'm not the man who once heard himself described as a handsome prince. That I can't be a Swan Island warrior after all. I can't be any sort of warrior. I can't even be the man who cleans the weapons and mends the boots, or the one who mops the floor, or the one who keeps the sheep from wandering where they shouldn't. There's no point, I growl. There's a silence. I hear Ahu move. He's leaving. Good riddance. I don't want him and his bad news. I don't want Jarber and his gentle voice. I don't want anyone. Dao, says Ahu, and his tone has changed. This is the voice he uses on Swan Island when someone makes a mistake, and I don't mean fumbling a combat move. He speaks like this when someone breaks the rules for daily life, the ones that keep our community orderly. Yes, it's a place devoted to the art of fighting, but that makes it all the more important, the elders told us when we were new to the place, that we practice courtesy toward others and learn to listen. I've just broken that rule. Not that it matters, since I no longer belong here. I remind you again that you are still part of our community. Ahu goes on, as if he can guess what I'm thinking. I am your senior on Swan Island. However furious you are at what fate has delivered, I still deserve your respect. You will address me and whoever else comes your way with that same respect. Without those codes, Dao, Swan Island could never have grown and developed into what it is. All right. I'm a seething mass of resentment right now, underlain with sheer terror, but I haven't forgotten how much I learned from this man, or how much freedom he allowed me and Liobhan on our mission, freedom that could have led to disaster, but ended up making the whole thing a brilliant success. Apart from the loss of Brock, of course. Some part of me knows I'm being unfair to Liobhan. If I try to explain to Ahu, I'll sound selfish. She's fit and strong, I'm not. She's still a Swan Island warrior, and whatever Ahu may say, I'm not. Hearing her voice will bring back a lot of memories. Memories that tell me now what the future might have been. Dao, He's waiting for a response. I'm sorry. Good. Now I have one more thing to say to you. As your elder and as your trainer, I want you to talk to Liobhan. You will do so today. I'm not asking. I'm telling. If you want someone else to be present, we can arrange that. Why must I talk to her? Because, Ahu says, I suspect she's the only one who can talk some sense into you. So please, conduct the meeting in a civil fashion. Keep your temper. Use the opportunity to talk about what happens next. She... I stop myself before I can say she knows nothing. Because of all the people I've met since I came to Swan Island, not counting a certain old woman in Brefna, Liobhan is the only one who knows how bad things were at home before I ran away. I haven't told her everything. Some of it I can't make myself say aloud. But she knows a fair bit, which means she will understand why I can't go back there, couldn't go back even as a fit, strong fighting man, and most certainly can't go as a crippled burden on my father's resources. It would be like walking willingly into a torture chamber. If anyone's likely to help me, it will be Liobhan. All right, I'll do it. And I don't want anyone else there. I promise not to attack her. Ahu does not speak. Not even with words, I add.
Chapter 5. Brock.
Brock!
Rowan motions me over to where he stands beneath an old oak. There, among its tangle of roots, a dark form is splayed out in a drift of feathers. There's blood. The thing's claws are curled tight, but there's nothing in them. Its eyes are open but unseeing. Don't touch, I warn as he crouches down beside it. Make sure it's dead.
It's dead.
Rowan's tone is flat as he picks up a stick and pokes it at the corpse, which rocks eerily to and fro against the tree roots. The leaves above us rustle in the wind. Out in the forest, the birds are quiet. We look down at the creature. This is the first time we've been so close to one of the crow folk, the strange beings that have established themselves in both Enya's realm and the human world. Creatures neither bird nor animal, but something else entirely. I fought them with song and with fire. I've seen them killed with knives. I've seen what remained of one of Enya's small folk after they had ripped it apart. I still do not know what they are, only that they attack without warning and without any discernible pattern. Since I came to live here among the fair folk, Rowan and I have set up regular patrols to keep watch on our strange enemy. Although I'm now Enya's husband, he is still her protector, her right-hand man. I'm content with that. The last thing I want to do is displace or offend any of her people. It must be strange enough for them that their queen has chosen a man of humankind to rule alongside her. Though I'm not entirely that. I have both fey and human blood, and so does Enya. I was raised in one world, she in the other, from the time she was 5 years old. Her folk love her. Me, they tolerate. They like my music. I am the first bard to live here in many years. It's still warm, I say, examining the dead thing more closely. It smells vile, like rotting fish. I use a stick to lift one wing, to investigate the dark, feathered body, so much bigger than that of an ordinary crow. I peer more closely at the fearsome beak, which gapes slightly open, and the glazed, staring eye. Rowan looks up into the oak, then scans the forest all around us.
I see no more of them, he says. Unusual for one to be out alone. How did it die, I wonder?
The creature has wounds. Beneath the tree roots on which it lies, the ground is stained with its blood. Look here, I say, lifting the other wing and wishing I could bring myself to touch the thing with my bare hands. This is no attack by wolf or eagle. These cuts were not made by a desperate man or woman fighting to survive. They look... What I see is hard to believe, hard to make sense of. In the tender area under the wing, the creature's skin has been burned away in narrow strips, exposing the raw flesh beneath. The strips are in a pattern, though the swelling makes it hard to see the exact shape, but it looks almost like an Oum sign or a rune of some kind, a brand of ownership, a mark of magic.
And there, on the beak,
Rowan points.
Perhaps the same symbol, not burned, but carved with a small sharp knife. Who could have got close enough to do that? We know how ferocious these things are.
I want to turn it over. Will you help me? Rowan looks somewhat like a fox and somewhat like a young man. I have no trouble reading the reluctance on his face. He too does not want to touch. But we take one wing each and turn the creature awkwardly onto its front.
Some claws damaged, Rowan says. See here, and some cut right off.
It's lost a lot of feathers. And there's something else, a collar of raw flesh right around the neck, swollen and festering.
Died of wounds, I murmur.
But such strange wounds. We look at each other.
Torture, says Rowan. Here, in Enya's realm, none of our folk would do this, nor could they. The crow folk are too strong.
It may not have been done here. The crow folk move freely between worlds, as birds and animals do. Sorry as I am to admit it, Rowan, I suspect the hand of humankind. But I don't understand why. There's a degree of cruelty here that troubles me greatly. We best head back and report this to Enya. But we hesitate, the two of us, standing over the broken body of an enemy.
We can't leave it like this, I say,
though my mind pictures our encounter with the crow folk last summer and the way they destroyed one of our little ones and hurt another.
We should lay it to rest.
We're far out in the forest, a long walk from the area where Enya's folk gather. Rowan has his knife of bone and I have a staff. The ground here must be full of tree roots. We won't be digging a grave.
You possess far greater compassion than I, Brock,
Rowan says.
Perhaps that comes of being a bard. I hate these stinking things. If I could burn it, I would. But there is a shallow cave not far from here. We could lay it there, perhaps cover it with what we find nearby. You might sing a song over it if you're feeling particularly tender-hearted.
He's teasing me, of course. We're friends. But when the creature is placed in its final resting place, hardly a cave, more a small hollow under a rocky overhang, and when we've laid a blanket of leaves and twigs over its damaged body with fallen branches to shield it, I stand quiet, considering. That death is a death, whether it be of friend or foe, one's own kind or an alien kind. The crow folk are cruel, destructive, and willful. Their attacks make no sense. They do not eat their kill, but leave it lying. They do not defend territory. Some travelers they let pass unmolested, others they swoop upon with talons at the ready to rip and slash and ruin. But there must be a reason for their madness. I have wondered if some malign spell was cast over them, if they were driven from their home, if perhaps they watched the unfolding of events so terrible their minds were forever blighted. This one has been killed in a particularly vile manner. No battle set those scars on its body. Rowan was right. It has been tortured to death. So, I sing. Not in the way I did when I drove them to the borders of Enya's realm, using my voice as a weapon to strike fear into them, but gently, as to a sleeping child. Be at peace. Your flight is o'er. Fold your wings on peaceful shore. May love and goodness wrap you close. Farewell to pain and grief and loss. Rowan steps forward to lay a small flower on the creature's final resting place. It's only when we're making our way back home that he asks me,
Is that a human thing, that you sing fair words over such a foul being? You know what they are. You have seen what they do.
Unless it died at the hands of one of its fellows, and the nature of the injuries did not suggest that, it seems the crow folk do not have a monopoly on evil deeds. And I wonder why they are the way they are. If we could know that, if we could talk to them, that might give us the key. Rowan makes a noise that tells me just what he thinks of that idea. It is indeed impractical. They see us coming, they attack, and if they don't attack, they stay high in the trees, watching. They are wild, unpredictable, violent. How could a man go about communicating with such a creature? How could I do such a thing without risking not only my own life, but those of all Enya's folk? I must be mad. A mad minstrel. I wish Liobhan was here. My sister is the voice of common sense, the voice of practical solutions. She is brave and decisive. I miss her so much. Enya is my beloved, and I'm fond of the strange beings that make up her clan. Along with Rowan, several others have become close friends to me. But Liobhan is my sister. We're almost of an age. I was left on her parents' doorstep less than a season before she was born. We grew up doing everything together, playing and singing, running and climbing and learning to fight. When I went with her to Swan Island to join the warrior band, I thought we would both stay there, together forever. But it was not to be. And now, here I am, wed to an otherworld queen, and, I suspect, about to displease her greatly. We find Enya in consultation with Nightshade, her sage. Nightshade has something of the owl about her looks, but in form, she's a woman. As for my wife, she might pass for fully human, as I did for so long. Enya's hair is brown and glossy. Today she has it plaited and pinned up high. Her eyes are a limpid gray. Her complexion is like the petals of a wild rose. Her expression is sweetly inquiring as she rises from the fallen tree on which she and Nightshade were sitting and steps forward to greet me and my companion.
"You were away a long time,"
she says, going up on tiptoes to give me a chaste peck on the cheek.
"We were concerned."
I love my wife. For her, I gave up my life in the human world, the precious gifts of family and home. I gave up much that was dear to me. But here in the other world, I'm still finding my place. When it gets hard, I think of Enya's story, reclaimed by her fey father at the age of 5, brought here and left among the unusual folk who make up her clan. At that tender age, she discovered she was a queen. Rowan and Nightshade and the others taught her how to rule, how to keep the peace, how to protect her folk as best she could. I am here to help them all. That is my life now. Sometimes I'm a little afraid of Enya. She's the sweet young woman who sings with me and walks through the woods with me and shares her bed with me at night. But she can turn in an instant to the Fae Queen who rules over this realm, the one whose anger is like a knife to the heart. I believe Enya truly loves me, but she does not always listen. We've found one of the crow folk, dead. I come straight out with it. I know that if I don't tell the full story, Rowan will, so I go on. Killed most terribly, perhaps by torture. We laid it to rest as best we could. There were no others of its kind in sight.
The bard sang over its resting place, says Rowan. Not the kind of fell song he uses to drive them off, but a song such as one might sing over a comrade fallen in battle or a dead child.
Enya turns her lovely, light-filled eyes on me. She says not a word. It was a cruel death, I say. The wounds had not been made by beak and claws, but by other weapons and by burning. I didn't want to leave the creature lying where it was, out in the open.
The crow folk are our enemies. They are malign. You say this was a cruel death. What, then, were the many deaths these evil things have inflicted on our own people? Are they not cruel? What of our defenseless little ones, ripped bodily apart and left to die in their blood? You think the crow folk worthy of dignity in death? You think them worthy of compassion? You are a warrior, not a priest, Brock. You are becoming too soft.
Anya's words hang in the air for a little. The rest of us are silent. Rowan looks down at the ground. Nightshade has turned her big eyes on me. I cannot tell what she's thinking, but she's a sage and will have weighed the matter up in her mind. Enya's cheeks are flushed, her lips are set tight. I am no priest, I say, holding on to calm. Only a bard, and sometimes a warrior, yes. The crow folk have performed terrible acts of violence. They have killed and maimed. They do not discriminate between good and bad, strong and weak, humankind or animals or fair folk. But I glance at Nightshade. But do you never consider why they behave as they do? Might not discovering that be the key to ending their attacks? I find it hard to believe they act thus for no reason at all.
And yet that is exactly how it is, says Enya.
She gets up and paces to and fro, her arms wrapped around herself.
We've seen it over and over. They will be the death of us. They will be the end of our people. Why would you waste your music over such a creature? Why would you waste your tears?
She cannot understand this. At such times, I'm reminded that she has spent far more of her life in the other world than I have of mine. It is less than a year since I came here. In 10 years' time, in 15, will I be like her in my thinking? Will the fae part of me outweigh the human? That troubles me. The fair folk often seem lacking in compassion. They find it hard to put themselves in other folk's shoes. The song was not wasted, Enya, I say quietly. It was a recognition of suffering. It was an acknowledgement of pain and loss. It was a wish that all creatures could rest easy. Perhaps it was only for the singer, who knows, an attempt to make sense of the senseless.
You speak wisely.
Nightshade gives me a grave nod of recognition.
My lady, when we face the darkness, when we face a battle whose odds seem impossible, is it not good to explore every pathway that might lead us into the light? You side with the bard.
Enya is sharp. She has her back turned to us. I know how the long struggle against the crowfolk has wearied her. I wonder if she hoped her bard and warrior, her new husband, would find a way to banish them forever within a season or two of his arrival in the other world. Alas, I'm not so remarkable a man.
A sage does not take sides,
Nightshade says.
She listens. She muses. Sometimes she offers suggestions.
And a bard sings and plays. Sometimes a song will come when he doesn't expect it. Sometimes a moment calls for music. I should stop talking before I say something I regret. Before Enya tells me a queen decides how things will be done and others obey, a husband included.
Your voice is our most powerful weapon, Brock. Your singing is the only thing that has halted their advance. We have used fire, of course. Their fear of it holds them back briefly until our brands die down or our bonfires are quenched by the rain. But since you came here, since you sang your song of death and flight, they have retreated to the very margins of my realm, at least.
Enya lifts her brows in question. Rowan has been very quiet. Now he speaks.
The creature we found dead was within the boundaries of our forest, yes. Far to the east, but not yet beyond Brefner's borders.
In my realm, or in the human world?
Rowan is uncomfortable. He drops his gaze, not meeting Enya's eye. Officially, our patrols go only as far as the edges of Enya's realm. Our duties do not extend to pursuing the crowfolk into what was my own world. To do so would put Rowan in particular at great risk. Most people out there think the fair folk a thing of ancient story, long gone, perhaps never real. He would be viewed as a freak, an oddity, something to be poked and prodded and kept for show. But as the crowfolk move easily between worlds, we cannot track their movements without sometimes crossing over. We've not spoken of this to Enya, not yet. Close to the place where the human kingdom of Brefner, King Phelan's land, meets that of the neighboring territory, I say, on the very eastern edge of the forest, Enya simply looks at me. I cannot tell you if the creature was killed within this realm or in the human world. I will not make this a confession. I refuse to be a child caught out in an act of naughtiness. I'm her husband, her equal. We laid it to rest close to where we found it. There's no way to tell what had befallen the creature, save what I have already told you of its wounds. Still, she doesn't speak. The silence draws out until I feel deep unease. This response is too much. Neither stepping over the border between worlds nor singing kindly over an enemy's corpse justifies it in my book. Is something else awry? What have I missed?
Come,
says Enya, her voice tight. She holds out her hand to me. This seems a good sign, and at the same time dismisses both Nightshade and Rowan with a jerk of her head. Her mouth is set grim, and when I take her hand, I feel the tension in her body. She leads me in the direction of the gathering place. But before we reach it, Enya takes a side path into a different part of the woods. Here, the trees grow close and the ground is always shaded. A streamlet flows between banks blanketed by water-loving herbs, cresses, and the like. Before us, a narrow bridge crosses this small waterway, a thing made from a single willow pole. It is a bridge for folk no bigger than the tiny birds that go between Enya's realm and the house of Mistress Juniper the Wise Woman, carrying messages. A mouse could traverse this bridge warily. A marten could sprint across.
Over here,
Enya says, leading me toward this delicate construction. I will not step on the willow pole and crack it. Even her slighter weight could not be supported there. Let me, I say, and lift her in my arms as if she were a child. I take one careful stride across the stream, then set her down on the opposite bank. For a moment, she lays her palm against my chest and looks at me with warmer eyes.
I need to show you something, Brock. Up here. Come quietly. We don't want to scare them.
Scare whom? I walk with her, treading as softly as I can. There's a rocky outcrop not far off, surrounded by thickly clustering bushes. Enya leads the way around this until an opening comes into sight, half concealed by that dense growth. She motions, finger to lips. Shh! Do I hear movement from within that secret shelter? Enya opens her mouth and calls softly. She doesn't use words. Her cry is like that of a bird at the earliest moment of dawn, melodious, gentle, almost tentative. I could write a song about that. There's a response, a tiny echo of the same sound.
I have the bard with me,
Enya says, still keeping her voice down.
May we come closer?
Come.
We move to the opening, a low arch into a shallow cave, too low for a person of my height to crawl through. The little shelter is well concealed from curious eyes, not only those of humankind, but also those of predatory birds, though I imagine a fox or badger might find the place easily enough. Within is one of Enya's smaller folk, Gentlefoot, a being of human shape, but clearly no human, for she comes barely as high as my knee, and her body is covered with soft brown fur. I remember that I've not seen Gentlefoot at our evening gatherings for some time, and when I see what she is cradling in her arms, I realize why. I make a small involuntary sound of surprise and wonder, and Enya glances at me, smiling. Gentlefoot has a baby. It is the first young one I've seen in all the time I've lived among Enya's folk. I do not need to be told how wonderful this is and how frightening. Enya drops gracefully to sit cross-legged on the ground outside the little cave. I kneel beside her.
How is he faring, Gentlefoot?
Enya asks.
Well, thank you, my lady. He has good appetite, and so do I. Mothweed has gone to fetch food. He will be back soon.
I'm thinking hard, thinking of beaks and claws and how far it is to the gathering place from here. The young one would be a single mouthful for a hungry owl. Gentlefoot herself would be no match for a fox. She and Mothweed and the little one need guarding, or they need bringing to the area where more of Enya's folk live so we can all watch over them. But I hesitate to say so. Enya's face is tender as she regards mother and child. Gentlefoot looks on her infant with glowing pride. The tight unease in my belly is at war with the delight in my heart. Already my thoughts are on the song I will make for this day.
We will wait with you until Mothweed returns, Enya says. Your child is remarkable, Gentlefoot, precious beyond any jewel.
No doubt she too is thinking how vulnerable they are out here, even in such a well-hidden shelter. Perhaps she is thinking that if Rowan and I were not taking risks out on the borders, we could stand guard over them. And there is a bigger, longer game in play. This child is a sign of hope. Its birth brings the possibility of renewal in Enya's realm. Her people may grow and flourish and become stronger, especially now Phelan has come to the throne of Brefner in the human world, a king who respects and understands the old things. More children may come. But the crow folk linger. My presence here is not enough to keep them away altogether, and they still wreak havoc in the outside world. By bringing me to see mother and infant, Enya is telling me I cannot afford a moment's weakness. I imagine her thoughts now as she chats with Gentlefoot in the quiet of the forest.
One day you lay a creature to rest with respect and with music. The next day one of its fellows seizes this most tender of small ones and rips it apart before its mother's eyes. If you would deal with the crow folk, you cannot afford softness, Brock. You must be as hard as iron and as cruel.
Chapter 6. Liobhan. It's a testament to Dao's abilities, I suppose, that even now he's blind, he manages to creep up on me and make me start in fright. I'm doing something I haven't done for a long while, playing my whistle. Ahu said to pack only essential items, but to me, this is essential. It'll stop me from going crazy waiting for Dao to get better, or for this deputation to arrive from Lord Scarnel. And let me say my piece before I turn into a snarling monster who couldn't watch her words if you offered her a bag of silver and a fine riding horse for her trouble. I'm in the area
where horses are exercised now, and because it's a fair way from the barn and there's nobody around, I'm taking the opportunity to run through a new jig I've been creating, checking whether what I hear in my mind translates well to the instrument. If the tune is a little too hearty for the situation, too bad. I suppose someday, who knows when, I'll return to the old routine of being a warrior by day and a bard by night. So I'm working through the last part of the jig, adding embellishments and cross rhythms, which takes some concentration, especially when the player's a little rusty, and a voice says right behind me, "Liobhan." Then, when I nearly jump out of my skin, he adds, in something resembling the supercilious tones of old, "You're slipping. What happened to being watchful?" I stick the whistle through my belt, get to my feet, and turn, all in a moment. There he is, apparently all by himself, with a stick in one hand, which I assume is to feel for obstacles before he crashes into them, and an expression on his face that makes me want to cry, because it's the ghost of the old one from our first training days, when he used that superior manner to make a wall around himself. He sounds every bit what he doesn't want to be, a chieftain's son and a man of privilege. I could say something cruel. I could say, "Keep that up and you'll fit right in back at home." But instead I say, "This seemed a safe enough spot. There's a bench here, about 2 paces ahead and to your right. Let's sit down and talk." I don't offer to guide him. I wait for him to find it. He leans the stick against the bench and seats himself beside me. He's lost weight. His face is bones and shadows. He was so strong before. A comrade to be relied on in battle, a fighter who would test me to my limit even in the bouts he lost. I hate to see that strength draining from him. It shouldn't happen. I want to ask if he's feeling better, but he'll slap me down for that, so I hold my tongue. We sit there for a while, long enough to hear the whickering of horses in the nearby stable and sounds of activity from elsewhere in the barn, where people are still preparing for a mission, and the creak of cartwheels as someone from the settlement goes by on the road that links our outpost to the wider world. "Why are you here?" Dow asks suddenly. He has his arms folded and his blind gaze straight ahead. "You mean here, playing the whistle in this particular spot, or here on the mainland?"
"Both, if you feel like talking."
He's going to make this difficult. That's no surprise. "I'm supposed to be helping the healers, but since I've been told you don't want me in there, I've been making myself useful any way I can." When Dow says nothing, I go on. "Ahu's been drilling me. He thinks that when this deputation comes from your father, they'll want to talk to me. He wants to be sure I won't lose my temper and make things worse. There, I've given him an opportunity to accuse me of poor judgment in choosing to fight without a helm. I've given him the chance to curse and shout at me all he wants. I almost wish."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.